Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome into Lakers Nation Live. I am Trevor Lane, and the Lakers pick up the win over the Philadelphia 76ers. A game, let's be honest, it was not pretty for much of the night, but the important thing, the Lakers walk away with the W, thankfully, and on top of that, making it even better, the Warriors lost tonight. The Warriors dropped their game to the Indiana Pacers, which now gives the Lakers a little bit more separation. Now the Lakers up a game and a half on the Warriors in the race between the 9 and the 10 seed. Now 2.5 games back behind the Sacramento Kings. Still 3 games behind the Phoenix Suns. The Suns, realistically, the team that the Lakers need to start dropping some games if they're going to look to move up into that 7-8 matchup. But again, I know. Let me just preface everything we're going to go over on this show here. I know a lot of you right now are looking at that game saying, that did not feel great. And with good reason. It was an ugly game. It was a sloppy game. It was a game that looked like March Madness. It looked like a couple of college teams turning the ball over left and right, missing free throws, missing lobs. It was ugly, but the important thing was it was a W. It's not a win where you come away feeling great. It's not a win where you come away saying, yes, see, this is what this team is. This is what they can be. You don't come away from this inspired, but it's a win. So we'll take it in that regard. But yes, this was a sloppy performance. This was a poor performance. This was a performance that you shouldn't see coming off of not one, not two, but 3 days off with all this time to plan for your opponent, knowing exactly what your opponent was going to do and what they're good at. And they still, the Lakers, struggled to pull out this win. So it was not a great performance. This was not one of those games that we're going to look back on and say, that was the game where we really saw what this Lakers team could do. No, if anything, it was more disappointing in terms of the overall performance. But in the playoff race right now, the important thing, the most important part, is they won the game. So I get that there's a lot of frustration out there, and there should be, based on how they played. But at the end of the day, to steal a phrase from Dennis Schroeder, it's a win. The big problem for the Lakers tonight, turnovers. 21 of them. And this is where if you're frustrated with this performance, once again, which was a win, and so we'll take it. But if you're frustrated, you should be. Because we talked about this on the show, on the podcast. We talked all about, it was one of our key points, the turnover battle. That the Lakers needed to keep the turnover battle close. The 76ers, they're one of the best teams in the NBA when it comes to not turning the ball over. And also one of the best teams in the NBA when it comes to turning over their opponents. And so we said one of the keys for the Lakers, since they are not very good at forcing turnovers from their opponents, at least have not been since the All-Star break, that they need to do a better job just maintaining control of the basketball. Don't get into a high turnover game, because that's how the 76ers, who are not good without Joel Embiid, they've been bad, I believe 9-15 now since losing Joel Embiid. They have not been good without him. You should beat this team. The way you make this difficult on yourselves is if you turn the ball over a lot. 21 turnovers on the night for the Lakers. That is atrocious. And I'll tell you what, the 76ers, their defense, I'm jealous of some of the stuff scheme-wise the 76ers were doing to try to take AD out of possessions in terms of when he's rolling to the basket. The way they doubled, they did a better job than we've seen opponents do. The Lakers were struggling. This is an area they've excelled. The Lakers were struggling to make shots, to create shots off of double teams on AD in the post. That's actually been an area the Lakers have been really good on the season, is those quick kickouts, move the ball, and then get an open look when opponents double AD in the post. The Sixers were pulling it off and not giving the Lakers open looks off of it. Their defensive schemes were on point. Credit to Nick Nurse, but there were also a lot of unforced turnovers for the Lakers in this one that made this game much more difficult than it should have been. But so again, frustration is warranted, but it's a win. So we'll take it. All right, let me see what the chat says. Mission 86 says that game was uglier than a 74 Gremlin. Wow. All right. But business handled. On to the next one. Still work to do. So face forward. Only way past is through. Master lock me for missing D'Lo's record 3. Yeah, I mean, maybe that's something that's certainly a positive from this game. D'Angelo Russell sets the Lakers record for made 3-pointers in a single season. D'Lo got that done. So there's a silver lining here to this game beyond just the win. D'Lo set that record, but yes, ugly game, and thank goodness it was a win. If they had found a way to lose this game, which for a little bit there looked like they might, fortunately, the 76ers, by the way, were awful. They were awful in this game. 76ers shot 21.6% from three. 34% from the field. That's how bad the 76ers were. And the Lakers barely, I mean, the 76ers have a decent shooting night. The Lakers could very well have lost this game. But thank goodness they didn't. Because, man, had they lost this game, it would be torches and pitchforks. And rightfully so, given that the Lakers were the heavy favorite coming into this game. And for them to blow it on turnovers would have been, I mean, just inexcusable. Madison, Philly, here we go. Philly, 21% from three. Lakers, 21 turnovers. Great defense. AD, MVP, GOAT. You know, I thought Anthony Davis, he was frustrated in this game. But one of the nice things about a lot of missed shots, which the 76ers missed a lot of shots, there are a lot of opportunities for rebounds. So Anthony Davis, 23 points, 19 rebounds, 4 assists, 4 blocks, 2 of 4 at the free throw line, 1 of 2 from 3. He hasn't been shooting the 3 lately. 1 of 2, knocked one down, 10 of 16 shooting. In fact, I don't think this is, we're not going to need to make a poll on this one. This is easy.
Superstar of the night.
It's AD. Anthony Davis easily the superstar of the night. I thought LeBron did not have a great performance in this one, especially by his standards. D'Angelo Russell was not necessarily great tonight. Anthony Davis stepped it up. And I thought AD played a very frustrated game. And I mean, AD himself was frustrated with the lack of calls that he was getting. You could see it from the opening tip. He was frustrated. He was getting hit in the paint and not getting calls. I think there were four times I counted, three or four, in the first quarter alone where AD stared down the official after getting contact at the rim and not getting a whistle. He was frustrated with the officiating in this game, but he played through it, grabbed those rebounds, and he was able to help power the Lakers to this win. Again, 23 points, 19 big rebounds. Again, part of that is the 76ers, they shot 34% from the field. That creates a lot of misses for AD to grab, but still, we will take it. We'll take it. So AD definitely gets the superstar of the night. And he did have those big blocks at the end. We had a block on Kyle Lowry, a block on Tyrese Maxey. He was fantastic. But Anthony Davis, 4 blocks in this game. And those two were particularly demoralizing, where the Sixers guards thought there was an opening, thought there was a little bit of space, and then suddenly AD just completely envelops them and knocks their shot. In fact, one of them, I think it was Lowry's, he blocked straight down and controlled it. I mean, incredible stuff on those blocks for Anthony Davis. All right. Cliff said, point of attack defense. Start Spence with D'Lo. You know, it's funny. Spencer Dinwiddie is one of the, essentially the Lakers' best guard defender. I mean, it's not named Cam Reddish. Cam returned in this game and he played. But Spencer Dinwiddie did a really nice job defensively. He, at the very least, was contesting shots well. So Cliff says, start Spencer Dinwiddie with D'Lo. Austin Reeves and Max or Cam are the backups. So trying to separate D'Lo and Austin, the two guys who are probably the weakest of the defenders of the guards, Dinwiddie being a little bit above. And that's not to say Dinwiddie's a great defender, but he's done okay this season defensively. And I thought tonight he had some really good moments, particularly on his contests. He did a good job. Also keep one of Rui or Braun on the floor at all times. Ham still going all offense or defense lineups, facepalm. Yeah, that was one thing that I don't know if I liked. I don't know if I liked Rui not getting minutes late in this game. And I get it. The reason for it was the Lakers wanted to have a Cam Reddish on the floor or a Spencer Dinwiddie on the floor to try to defend Tyrese Maxey. It makes sense. I'm not saying I'm upset with it, but Rui really had it going on the offensive end. I thought the Lakers did a really nice job when the 76ers early in the game were trying to get away with having smalls rotate onto Rui. And the Lakers were just saying, thank you. Here's the ball, Rui. Do your thing. And he did. So to see Rui utilized so sparingly in the second half was a little disappointing. But again, there was some method to the madness. This wasn't just you know, screaming, why is Rui not on the floor? It made sense in the moment. You're trying to defend Tyrese Maxey. I got it. But still felt like Rui probably should have gotten a few more opportunities there in the second half. But overall, I thought it was a pretty solid game from Rui Hachimura. As far as going all offense or all defense, welcome to the season, right? welcome to the season. This team is really set up to have a mix and match kind of hodgepodge of defensive players and offensive players. And that's not ideal. Ideally, you want five guys on the floor who can all do both things, who can all defend and all at least shoot, if not shoot and create, right? That's your best case scenario. And that's what the Lakers don't have. They've got a team full of guys that can either play offense or play defense. And what you need to do is mix and match those guys and be able to read the game and feel out exactly what mixture needs to be on the floor at what time. And I think you're right, Cliff, with this criticism. I think Darvin does go all offense or all defense too often. And it creates these imbalances. I mean, we see it where teams don't defend Cam Reddish behind the three-point line. So that's going to create some issues for you on the offensive end. We saw it earlier in the season when he went with the all-defense lineup with Torian and Torian Prince was out for this game, by the way. But Torian Prince, Cam Reddish, Jared Vanderbilt, LeBron AD, no guards, all defense out there on the floor. That, not surprisingly, the offense suffered. Darvin has this resistance to mixing and matching to the degree that this team really needs him to. And it's been one of the more head-scratching things, I think, that we've seen over the course of the season is not getting more mixing and matching opportunities between these offensive players and the defensive players. It's been really, really weird. But, all right, let's move on here. Joseph said, reffing in this game was highly sus. I feel so much younger when I say that, sus. AD didn't see a shooting foul until late in the third. Buddy Hield shot clock. Yeah, the Buddy Hield shot clock, though, they went back and they removed that bucket. He had the finger roll when the clock had expired, and it was close, but they went back and they retroactively took away that basket. So they handled it there. But can't help but feel if AD's surname was Embiid, the Cam BS is back. No Rui in the fourth. Cam had some decent plays on the defensive end of the floor. So I wasn't surprised he got 19 minutes. Not too. You knew the Darvin was going to lean on him, especially in a matchup like this, trying to throw guys at Tyrese Maxey and try to at least slow him down a little bit. AD not getting foul calls. You know, we joked about it over on Playback, playback.tv/LakersNation, where you can hang out with us during the games or right here on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. By the way, if you're here on YouTube right now, guys, smash the like button for me. Hit that like button. If you're not subscribed to the channel yet, hit that subscribe button as well. Let's get those likes up. Get this out to as many people as we can. But yeah, if Anthony Davis's surname was Embiid, he couldn't seem to get much of a call tonight, much of a whistle. He only took four free throws. If you watch this game, AD got hit way more than that. Like, he should have probably been double digits in free throws, and he sits at four on the night. You look at Jackson Hayes even. Jackson Hayes has this habit of hitting the offensive glass, and then on the putback, he gets fouled. He rarely converts the putback, but he at least gets to the free throw line. That happens pretty frequently with him. AD can do the exact same thing and get hit, and because AD's got 20, 25 pounds on Jackson Hayes, he doesn't go to the ground on that contact, and he doesn't get the call. And I wonder if it's just that simple. Because AD stays straight up and down, Embiid would be flying into the first row. You know he's not afraid to hit the floor or anything like that. He's gonna act on that. Jackson Hayes gets knocked down quite a bit. Those guys get the calls. Anthony Davis, especially tonight, he's getting hit, can't get a whistle. It was not a great night for the Lakers. They didn't play well. Not a great night for the 76ers. They didn't play well. It's also not a great night for the officials. I didn't feel like they had a very good outing in this one either. No Rui in the fourth. Talked about that one a little bit already. It's a little bit surprised, but I also get it. I mean, Tyrese Maxey, he's ultra quick. Rui certainly wasn't going to be able to defend him back there. All right, chat. I'm curious on this one. The star in your role. Who stepped up and filled their role the best? Let me know in the chat. I've got one guy that I'm kind of zeroed in on, but I want to see if everybody agrees.
Star in your role.
Star in your role. Who should get this one? Okay. This is what I thought. So you guys are with me. You guys are with me then. Star in your role. I'm seeing a lot of Spencer Dinwiddie. I'm seeing a lot of Spencer Dinwiddie, and that's where I was too. Brian says Spencer. Ed Carter says Spencer. Yep. I'm seeing a lot of Spencer Dinwiddie. Mamadou says Dinwiddie. Yep. Yeah. I got to go Spencer Dinwiddie in this one. You know, you look at this game. Was this his best game as a Laker? No, probably not quite. And certainly not the biggest moment. Blocking Damian Lillard was the biggest moment, but I thought he afforded himself pretty well defensively. I liked what we saw out of him there. And then 3 for 6 from three. Where, I mean, that's got to be his best three-point shooting night as a Laker. 2 assists, but I mean, it's not like he stuffed the stat sheet, but 11 points. He was a +8 on the night in plus minus, and 3 of 6 from deep, made some timely shots for the Lakers. And defensively, I liked what he did in this one. So Spencer Dinwiddie, despite not having a box score that necessarily jumps off the screen at you, 11 points, 2 assists, 3 of 6 from three, I thought he had a really nice night. And frankly, you look at everybody else, just about every player, aside from Anthony Davis, played a subpar game. Austin, the stats aren't bad. 14 points. He did hit some threes late, which certainly helped the Lakers. 6 boards, 5 assists. Had a big rebound late as well. 2 of 5 from three. He kind of found his way into this game, but there were some rough moments early from Austin in this one. D'Lo, 4 for 13 shooting. That's just not efficient enough. +5 turnovers. LeBron, 8 turnovers. Good Lord. I mean, 28 and 6 for LeBron, but 8 turnovers, and some of them were particularly careless. That was rough. Rui was 4 for 10 shooting. I like that Rui had 7 rebounds. Again, there were more rebounds to get to, but rebounding has been a key area that I've really been harping on with Rui Hachimura, that he's got to give them a little bit more there. And tonight he did. Again, part of it was there were more rebounds available to grab, but still 7 boards for Rui. You'll take that. 7 offensive boards for AD. That's impressive. But everybody else, I thought, played at best an average game, if not a below average game. And I thought for Spencer Dinwiddie, based on what we've seen out of him so far, he was a guy who stepped up. So I definitely think he's deserving of the Star in Your Role award. And I liked what we saw out of him. Yeah, comment here says Dinwiddie was really challenging shots, not just putting his hand up, as Trevor here says. Great name. Yeah, I love the way that he was contesting shots tonight, particularly in the paint on a couple of fadeaway shots. Dinwiddie was doing a great job contesting. So that was great to see. All right, let me get back to the chat here. Trey said, these MFs will try their hardest to lose a game, won't they? LeBron tried to get a triple-double with turnovers. So I won't go as far as to say they were trying to lose the game, but they did make life difficult on themselves. And you know what? Again, this is what was disappointing, was that this comes after one of the longest stretches of the season of not having any games. No games, so you had time to practice. So you've got time to practice. You've got time to work on all your stuff. You're rested. You're not playing the second night of, if this was the second night of a back-to-back, the fourth game in 5 nights, or, you know, something like that. Okay. All right. Like this, that would be, while it would still be bad, that would explain this. But tonight, this was coming off of 3 days off. You had 2 days in a row of practice. And you still looked discombobulated and kind of a mess. And part of it is you have to give credit to Philly's defense. Part of it is give credit to Nick Nurse, to the schemes that he came up with. Thought they were really good. In fact, I'm a little concerned that just like last season when Nurse was coaching the Raptors and he took AD out of a game that way, are we going to see teams kind of blitz the Anthony Davis post-ups the way the 76ers team did? The Lakers really struggled to adapt to that. Is that going to become a thing that other teams pick up on now, just like teams last season picked up on the way the Raptors were over-helping onto AD and preventing his rolls to the basket And that really caused a lot of problems for the Lakers offense. And that's where people got so upset last year with Anthony Davis for like a 9-point outing or a 12-point outing or whatever. A lot of that was defenses were really doing what they could to take him out of the game offensively. And that all stemmed from that game against the Raptors and Nick Nurse and what he developed to go against AD. So you got to give some credit to the Sixers defense, of course, but I did think that the Lakers really looked more rusty than you should after, yes, 3 days off, but it's not like it was 3 days on the beach. It was 3 days with two practices in there to work on all this stuff, to have all this stuff ironed out. And they still just look sloppy. I mean, really, we've been watching a bunch of March Madness games. It looked like that. That's how sloppy it was. It looked like a March Madness game. It looked like college kids out there for some moments. Surprising. I could be surfing, saying having a hard time taking this team seriously. Right. Like, I get it. I get it. Having a hard time taking this team seriously. Because what have they said? What have they been saying recently? We've been hearing a lot of every game's a playoff game from here on out. Every game's a big game, right? Like this is the stuff that the Lakers are saying these things. This isn't me like pumping the like, oh, big game tonight. This is the players themselves, Darvin Ham, saying these things. Every game's a playoff game now. Every game's a big game. Every game's a must win. And then they came out and didn't really look like it for much of this game, did they? When you're not backing up your words with action, that's concerning. Now, of course, this is coming on the heels of the last game was a 31-point blowout over the Hawks. They looked like they were taking things seriously then. And sometimes you have an off night. That happens. Sometimes you have an opponent that just plays scrappy and mucks up the game and all that. But this Lakers team, coming off of a three-day rest, they really didn't look like they approached this game as though this is a must-win, this is a playoff game for us. It didn't look like they went, wow, we've got a chance to create some separation with Golden State. We really got to get this win. And so when you say, I can't take this team seriously, I understand it because they're not backing up their words with action, at least not consistently enough. We're not seeing that. Now, hopefully, this is a blip. This is just a sloppy game. And next game coming up against Indiana, who's probably going to want some revenge after losing to the Lakers in the in-season tournament. By the way, thank you, Pacers, for beating the Warriors tonight. We appreciate that. But they'd better step it up for Sunday's game. So I'll tell you what, the Pacers are not going to be nearly as forgiving as the 76ers were. The Pacers aren't going to shoot 21% from three. They hopefully aren't going to turn you over 21 times either, but the Pacers aren't going to shoot 21% from three. The Pacers aren't going to let you off the hook for making so many mistakes. Most good teams in the NBA will not let you off the hook the way the 76ers did with the Lakers tonight. So I sure hope that on Sunday, this looks much different and they look much, much better out there. They have to. They have to, simply. Otherwise, Sunday's not going to go well. It's that simple. Ed said, we won, but I don't have much else positive to say. I feel you, Ed. I feel like I jumped into a time machine and went back to October of 2022. Yeah, you're talking about the 0-2, what was that? The 2-10 start to the season. Sloppy. It wasn't pretty, folks. I mean, it wasn't. It was not an enjoyable basketball game. But again, how much worse would it be had it been a loss? So we'll take it. NAD on the boards. That's a silver lining. D'Angelo Russell, all-time record for threes. There's some positives. But we got to go digging for him a little bit. Said, we're not making the playoffs. Okay. It's alarming the lack of fundamentals we have and mind-boggling. We can't improve on them this far in the season. At this point in the season, It's just not about winning. It's how you look winning, and we look bad. You know, I think most of the time, I'd probably push back on that. And I would say, you know, no, right now it's about wins. But I kind of think he's right. Right? Because for the Lakers, like we know, best case, right? The Lakers are going to wind up in the 8 seed. That's the best case. And that's going to take Phoenix losing some games and the Lakers winning some games. So this was an important game to win. But you're in the play-in no matter what. You're going to be in the play-in unless Houston just keeps winning and somehow the wheels fall off completely. Something unforeseeable happens, right? You're going to be in the play-in. So really the most important thing, it's can you get back to your in-season tournament level of play? Can you get back to that? What does it take to get back to that? And part of it may be health. I think that is a pretty decent part of it. But what do you need to do to get back to that level of play? If you win a bunch of games, but you're kind of fortunate to win them, and you look like this, because this is who you are as a team now, which I don't think this is who they are as a team right now. I think this is a bad night. But if this becomes more commonplace and they still kind of stumble into some wins, that doesn't bode well for their longevity in the postseason, right? Because the postseason is not going to be forgiving to this kind of basketball. It's just not. The most important thing you can argue over winning and losing right now, as important as that is, the most important thing is the Lakers finding their way again. Because if they somehow find that in-season tournament form, they are a much different team. They're a much more dangerous team. Now, that team was getting it done with defense. That team that we saw 3 months ago, 3+ months ago, they were getting it done with defense. This team can't defend anybody. They're getting it done with offense. So, or in general, they can't. I thought there were some decent defensive possessions tonight, but in general, they're not defending well. So the most important thing is getting back to that form, the in-season tournament level of play. And so if you're winning these games and you look bad, it's not a great sign. Not a great sign. But again, I thought they looked pretty good last game against the Hawks. And we've got some good news on Jared Vanderbilt. It sounds like he's actually ahead of Gabe Vincent in the return now. Okay. That is the biggest thing for the Lakers right now. The biggest key in terms of the guys who are out returning, it's Jared Vanderbilt by a lot. It's not close. If you get Vando, I hope you can get him at like 90%. If he can be 90% of what he was right before he went out, that makes a big difference. It's a big difference maker given what this team needs. So that's going to be really important too. Jared Vanderbilt coming back and coming back somewhere close to what he was right before he left. That would make a big difference for this team. Why no Rui in the fourth? He was cooking. I wish we had gotten some more Rui Hachimura in the fourth quarter. Maybe even just to start the fourth to give you some scoring punch. But we didn't see that much. And again, a lot of it, I think, was about Tyrese Maxey. Tyrese Maxey is great. He's great. 10 for 26. Thank goodness Tyrese Maxey shot 1 for 9 from three. He's a good three-point shooter, and he shot 1 for 9. 27 points, and he had a terrible shooting night from three. Terrible shooting night. And he was getting to the rim pretty much when he wanted. He's a 38% three-point shooter, and he shot 1 for 9 tonight. So the Lakers were fortunate in that regard. But with him on the floor, I understand Darvin looking down his bench and thinking, gosh, who can I put on this guy? Maybe come somewhere close to staying in front of him. That's all they were looking for. And so it made sense, but I thought Rui played really well early in this game, and I thought he should have gotten a bit more of an opportunity. All right, jumping in right now. We've got my guy, Mark Guttles. Mark, hey. How you doing?
Good win tonight, so I'm feeling pretty good.
Feeling good? All right. Mark, what did you see in this game? Before we get, I know we have you come on to talk about sleeper and we make our selections and all that. Give me your rundown of this game. Give me your perspective. What did you think? Lakers Sixers, they get the win, but a lot of fans were not that impressed.
Yeah, I mean, obviously you don't have Embiid in the game. You know, you expect to see a little more cleaner game overall and not as much stress. But I think for the most part, if you looked at it from a LeBron perspective, he came out really slow in this game. He wasn't even looking for his own offense. So I think it was one of those LeBron games where he wanted to get his guy. Sorry, I got muted there. I heard you mention Rui had a good start, probably should have played more as the game went on. But I think all in all, I think you saw some good things there. Defensively, I thought they did a really good job of making things tough for Philadelphia. They shot under, what, about 30% from the field in this game, roughly. So, I mean, I think you shut their water off, made things tough for them, and you dominate on the glass. Yeah, they were, what, plus 10 on rebounds in this game, I believe. Mm-hmm. Obviously, with no Embiid there, something you are looking forward to seeing happen, especially with AD getting, what, 19 of them. And how about those block shots on Maxey in the fourth quarter?
That was great.
Yeah, I thought that was really good. It showed he was really active tonight. So I wouldn't be too down on this game.
So when I'm looking at this, I get that there's a lot of frustration from fans saying they did not look good. I said they didn't look like they really treated this as a playoff game, but you're seeing the positives on the defensive side of the ball. That actually could be big. And that's something that maybe I'm not giving enough credit to, because their problem so far this season, at least since the All-Star break and even a little bit before, it's been their defense, because it's been awful. They've been one of the worst defensive teams in the NBA. Fortunately, their offense has been fantastic. Tonight, the offense was awful. The defense was pretty good, as you said. Some of it was just the Sixers missed shots, but some of it was indeed the Lakers defense. So does this actually make you more optimistic that now we saw some flashes of a better defensive performance? Now if they can carry that forward, the offense will come back around a bit, like that's gonna happen, and then you're gonna have a more well-rounded team? Is that where you're kind of landing from this?
Yeah, and I think they both kind of go hand in hand. You're talking about the offense and defense. Like a lot of guys, when their shots aren't falling, they're not that good on the defensive end, right? It kind of affects how they play on that end. But I like how that didn't really come into play tonight. Like you said, there was definitely some missed shots, some missed opportunities for Philadelphia in this game. So it wasn't perfect defense. But I do think I saw some signs to where they can get after. I mean, they got some really good guards over there. Obviously, Maxey, the head of the snake. Oubre on the perimeter is a pretty good player as well. You got Tobias Harris, who can mix things up from the forward position. So even without NB, they still have some talent over there.
Ed says, when did Mark become Matt the Optimist? we've had a lot of doom and gloom tonight, and you're coming in here with the optimism. I kind of like it. You know what? And I hope you're right. I hope this is a positive sign for the defense, and it's going to pay dividends, because next game, the defense is going to maintain, and the offense is going to come back around to what we've been getting used to over the last few weeks. All right, let's talk a little bit about our sponsor here, which is Sleeper. They always are a fantastic sponsor for us. And Sleeper is a great promo right now. You guys can use the QR code that you see on the screen. Get a $500 first-time deposit match with our code Lakers Nation. You can click the link in the description down below. Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, we're going to take the free square there. 0.5 points. Yeah, he's going to score more than that. The MVP candidate. I don't think he wins it, but I'd give it to Jokic, but I think he scores more than a point. Let's take a look at DeJounte Murray. We've played DeJounte Murray quite a bit here, and yeah, I've liked what we've seen out of him. I'm looking at some of these numbers. I wonder if they're a little bit high here for him. Like, I'm looking at 41.5 points, rebounds, and assists. He's gotten that twice in his last four against Charlotte. I don't know. How do you feel about that one?
Charlotte. So I'm always thinking about, is the game going to be close or a blowout factor? I think I got to go lower on this one.
Yeah, that's the way I was leaning as well. Chat, I'm assuming you guys go, yep, Ed says lower. All right, let's get another one here. And the Rockets have been red hot. They've won 7 in a row right now. Fred VanVleet going up against a Utah team that is pretty clearly they're done. I wonder. What's he done in terms of 12 and a half rebounds and assists combined? Yep. He's cleared that mark in three straight games. Yeah. And the one game he didn't, he hit 12. I was feeling pretty good about that number before I clicked on that.
And then the two games before that where he didn't hit it, he got over. He was higher on that. So that's like, what, five of his last six games?
Yeah.
He's cleared this. So we definitely got to go higher there.
All right. So we're going to go more on Fred VanVleet than 12 and a half. I think that's pretty good right there. The chat says Jalen Brunson points. New York against Brooklyn, he's at 29 and a half. He's cleared that mark in three of the last four. Chat, I think we'll take that from you. We'll add that one to the mix here.
Oh, we'll getting a little more. Spicy today.
Yeah, let's do it. Why not? Jalen Brunson, we'll go more. All right, so here's our entry. We've got a 9X entry. A $20 entry would get you $180 payout here with the SGA free square, DeJounte Murray, Fred VanVleet, Jalen Brunson. Again, you guys want to play along with us, use that QR code that you see on the screen. Or if you're over on the, if you're just watching the video on YouTube, you can click the link in the description down below as well. And use our code Lakers Nation. Get that $500 deposit match. Mark, I think that's a pretty good one.
That's a good one. We added an extra. We added an extra play this time from the listeners. So I like that.
I like it. All right. Well, hey, Mark, I definitely appreciate you coming on. I know you've got to run, but next show we'll have you come on and hang out for the whole thing. We'll break down everything.
Let's do it.
All right. Sounds good. Well, thank you again for stopping by, Mark. I appreciate it.
No problem. Go Lakers.
History Man says, it was great seeing Trevor on the Dodger Blue channel this afternoon. Yeah, so Dodger Blue, guys, if you guys haven't checked them out, Dodger Blue 1958 on YouTube, they are fantastic. They do incredible. Blake Williams went to Korea to go cover the games there. The Dodgers were involved in. They do an incredible job. And so they needed Jeff Spiegel, who's amazing. He was not available. Daniel Starkan was not available. He was heading to the arena, and they needed somebody to jump on. And I said, I will jump on and play the host role and do that. And so it was pretty fun getting to talk Dodgers baseball for a little bit there. We were breaking down with Matthew Moreno, who is absolutely fantastic. We were breaking down the Shohei Ohtani news and everything that's been going on there. So that was a lot of fun going over there and talking a little bit of baseball. Baseball is not my primary sport. I fall more into the casual fan category in baseball, but I'm excited for the Dodgers this season. And I hope this Ohtani stuff doesn't turn into something bad. But yeah, I was it was a good time getting to moonlight over there with Dodger Blue for a little bit earlier today. All right, let's get into a few more of your questions. Then we're going to get to our favorite segment, the Master Lock of the Night. We'll do a couple more of these. Tricksters, why can't we ever beat an injured team / bad team comfortably? It makes me so mad. It always has to be a fight like this game. Well, let's keep things in context here. Remember, let's keep things in context. The Lakers, in their last game, they blew out an injured team, the Atlanta Hawks, by 31. So there's that. Right? Let's not forget that. Sometimes those games do happen, and we just don't remember them because it was an easy coast, you know, cruise of a win. And the more difficult games are the ones that stick with you, right? Because you were expecting them to get an easy win against a team that's, you know, missing players and everything. You expect the win. And so when you get what you expected, that doesn't necessarily stick in your memory. Whereas when something unexpected happens, it really stands out. So that's part of it. That's part of it. But I think in general, over the course of the entire season, have the Lakers played down to their opponents? But I think that's what we're really asking here. Do the Lakers play down to their opponents? Yeah, I think so. I think they do. They do play down to their competition. They also play up to their competition. We see them step up against some of the better teams in the NBA as well. So I think that has been something to consider when we're watching this team. You kind of know when they're going into a game that they should win. Sometimes we get those games like the Hawks, but more often than not, you wind up in more of a fight than you would hope. But the flip side is, a game where you were kind of expecting them to get blown out, they'll show a bit more fight than you were necessarily expecting. So there's that too. The good and the bad of it. But yes, I think they do play down to their competition at times. And I think at least on the offensive end, that's what we saw in this one, particularly with the turnovers. Samuel said, another day, another dub. God bless, and here's to more. Thank you, Samuel. Appreciate that. Appreciate that. Yeah, we'll take the win. DJ, and then we're going to get into the master lock of the night. That win feels like a loss. The Lakers showed up to this date underdressed and sloppy. The unforced turnovers. Matt the Optimist Peralta would appreciate the dating references there. The unforced turnovers kept Philly in the game. Playoff LeBron, we got lucky. Next date, we need to bring it. Yeah, I mean, for a LeBron that we thought he was going to, you know, teammates have been talking about how he's going to step it up, turn it on, all that stuff. We got one of the sloppier performances out of LeBron on the season. Again, 8 turnovers. Didn't look great in this one. But again, showed up at the end when the Lakers hit a big 3, made some big plays. Still does LeBron things, but was a bit careless with the basketball in this one. Sunday against the Pacers, they got to bring it. They got to bring it. That Pacers offense is really, really good, and the Lakers have got to bring it on that one. Again, they've made up some ground here now, have a game and a half cushion over the Warriors. Great. Got to keep it rolling. Got to win the next one. I believe it's 12 games left in the season now for the Lakers. All right, everybody, let's get to it. The master lock of the night. What was the most annoying thing from this game? Put it in the chat. Let's go.
Master lock of the night.
The master lock of the night. What is it? Yeah, I kind of wonder if this is an easy one here. Is it the turnovers? Is it the turnovers? Like, I haven't even seen. All right, Ed says, master lock, Nick Nurse or the refs in general? Oh, the foul on Austin Reeves. That is a good one. The foul on Austin Reeves when Braun pushes Tobias Harris into him and Austin Reeves fell over. Loved Austin Reeves' facial expression during the call. That was, like, if we've ever seen anything that says never leave it in the hands of the officials or the referees, it's that one. They reviewed it. I thought, if anything, it would be a charge on LeBron, right? If it wasn't a blocking foul on Tobias Harris, it was going to get flipped into a charge on LeBron. LeBron lowers his shoulder, raises the elbow a little bit, and Tobias Harris goes flying and lands on Austin Reeves. Austin is just kind of standing there, right? Then he gets flattened by a flying Tobias Harris. And the referees go and they review it, and they decide somehow, some way, it's a foul on Austin Reeves. It was called on the floor a foul on Tobias Harris. It gets turned into not a foul on LeBron, a foul on Austin Reeves, who got flattened. He was just standing there and has a man land on him. And it becomes a foul on Austin. That was pretty rough. That was pretty rough. Cameron Payne, just because. I get it. Master lock Dylan Brooks. Yep. He gets master locked every night. Gary says the same thing. Oh, another good one. Tobias Harris hitting LeBron with the elbow. Probably should have been an offensive foul. Gave him an elbow to the jaw while he was attacking the basket. Yeah, definitely. I think ultimately, where do I have to land? It's here. Turnovers. Got to be turnovers. Turnovers have got to get master locked in this one. They were 21. Way too much. Again, I think the Lakers average, 12, something like that, per game on the season. Way, way too many turnovers in this game. And really, the way I look at turnovers, just so everybody's clear, I tend to look at turnovers where we incorporate your points per possession stats. So points per possession for a lot of teams, it's typically averages out to about 1. Yeah, the Lakers averaged 13 turnovers per game on the season. They had 21 in tonight's game. Typically, I look at turnovers and say, okay, every turnover that you've got, if you're averaging 1 point per possession, roughly, essentially each turnover is minus 1 point off of your total score. So if you have 20 turnovers instead of 10, that's 10 points that you, on average, would have scored otherwise that you just gave up. So when you look at the end of the game, if you lost by five, you okay, well, there it is. There's the turnover problem. In this game, the Lakers gave up 21 turnovers. 13 is their average. So we're talking about 8 points. The whole complexion of this game changes if the Lakers have another 8 points on their total. Now, again, games fluctuate. You know, some games you have higher turnovers, some games you have less. But that's the way I look at turnovers. It's too easy when you're watching the game to just go, whoa, they turned the ball over, but the action keeps moving. And it's too easy to just to kind of look past it and just say, well, you get, you know, they're going to come back. They're going to get it back on the other end or something like that. If you look at it and every time you see a turnover, you think that's minus one, minus a point, minus a point, minus a point. I think to me anyway, it drives home how damaging turnovers actually are in the NBA. It's one of my pet peeves. It's especially unforced turnovers. Good teams are not going to turn the ball over like this. And then the other thing is controlling the offensive glass because of how damaging that can be, giving up open threes in today's league. Those are two of, I think, the most important stats to watch. It's offensive rebounds given up and turnovers. They really make a big, big difference. We get too focused on just field goal percentage, three-point percentage, total points scored, the turnovers, the offensive rebounds surrendered. Those are really, really important stats that can make a big difference in winning or losing a game. All right, guys, we'll do one more here. I Could Be Surfing said, what would be your reaction if Ham came back next season? Then I'd be asking when the parade is being planned, because or how great was the parade, because clearly the Lakers won the championship. I mean, right? Honestly, look, I've talked about this a lot. I want Darvin Ham to find success with the Lakers. I would love it if the team turned it around, but from afar, the body language doesn't look great. To me, it's noticeable that guys aren't speaking up or speaking favorably of Darvin often. D'Lo last game after the Hawks said he appreciated the trust Darvin is showing in him. So, okay, that's something, right? But something is off with this team, I think. You see them play other teams, and I mean, like tonight against the 76ers. I thought the Lakers played well defensively. But there were a lot of moments where you saw what the Sixers were doing defensively and you thought, okay, that's a different level than some of the things we see out of the Lakers more often than not. Darvin's whole thing is this team is supposed to be constantly willing to run through a brick wall for him, right? That's supposed to be this great motivator. We haven't really seen that. So I would be very surprised if he's back next season, unless they make a real deep playoff run and everything clicks. And I do think that LeBron having a player option, and I think D'Lo having a player option this year and having the ability to be free agents, that's probably going to be a factor. Because let's face it, the Lakers are going to ask the question, hey, LeBron, you know, what do you think about Darvin? Is him being the coach something that's going to matter when it comes to you coming back or not? And LeBron's not going to want to be the final say on something like that, but I don't know how bought in LeBron is with Darvin. So at this point, I would be surprised if he's back next season. It's not impossible. The decision hasn't been made, obviously, and there's a long way to go, right? And if they make a deep playoff run, maybe that's it. And he sticks around. But I think right now, more likely than not, it's going to be somebody else at the helm next season. All right, everybody. I do appreciate all of you for joining. We do get KD is a new channel member. If you guys haven't checked out the channel membership program, click the join button. You guys can check that out. Really cool. We offer some great perks for channel members, and it's a great way to help support the show, help support the channel, all that. So make sure you guys check that out. If you haven't checked out the channel membership program, we do our weekly get together too. All our channel members come in, they come on stage or on screen and everything. We all talk Lakers basketball. It's a good time. So check that out. Click the join button, but I appreciate all of you guys joining. Sean is going to be starting up the post-game show in just a few moments. So make sure you guys stick around for that. Thank you, everybody. I know it wasn't pretty, but it was a win. Till next time, everybody. See ya and stay safe.